Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Antiquities, What Everyone Needs to Know, by Maxwell L. Anderson. Narrated by Maxwell L. Anderson. To Chase and Devon. Acknowledgments. The call from Oxford University Press to undertake this book was a welcome surprise. Nearly 40 years of studying and caring for public collections of ancient art should logically have equipped me to offer something useful. But the challenge of even-handedly assessing relevant issues in such an important, complex, and ever-changing field was not one I took lightly. While debates about ethics and practices with respect to collecting antiquities can quickly become heated and personal, I've done my best in the present book to be fair to divergent positions and refrain from impugning the motives of those with strongly held beliefs. Antiquities, What Everyone Needs to Know, does not pretend to be comprehensive or unbiased, since neither attribute could describe an enterprise so brief and of necessity colored by personal experience. It's instead offered up as a toolkit to help the reader develop informed opinions when confronted with information about the past, whether during a visit to a museum, monument, or archaeological site, while reading a news item, or upon encountering an archaeological artifact for sale. As is the case with any publication demanding months of research and writing, the author is obligated to many people. My principal debt is to my family for allowing me to slip away and burrow into the project. Archaeologists, museum administrators, curators, conservators, legal experts, and dealers have also enriched my appreciation of the divergent positions in this field, from undergraduate days to the present. Professor Matthew Winkie at Dartmouth College cajoled me into applying to graduate school in ancient art. Harvard's inimitable Professor George M. A. Hanfman was unfailingly encouraging as I pursued my PhD, reminding me when I was juggling research, writing, and teaching that there are 24 hours in the day, and then there are the nights. The Metropolitan Museum of Art's Dr. Dietrich von Bothmer gave me an office in the Department of Greek and Roman Art for 10 years, throughout my passage from graduate student to curator. While I came to recognize that his swashbuckling methods of collecting were anachronistic, he generously extended to me and others a memorable and lasting scholarly platform. The Metropolitan Museum's peerless director, Philippe de Montebello, supported my evolution as a curator at every turn and taught me much of what I took into a subsequent career as a museum director. The Metropolitan's general counsel, Sharon Cott, has been an unflappable source of even-handed wisdom for over two decades, as has Josh Nerley, general counsel to the Association of Art Museum Directors, and Susan Taylor, former president of the Association of Art Museum Directors and today director of the New Orleans Museum of Art. My dear friend Professor Eugenio La Rocca, former director of the Capitoline Museums, and among the world's leading scholars of Greek and Roman art, introduced me to the key protagonists in Italy's archaeological establishment, helped see to my appointment as a visiting professor of Roman art at the University of Rome, and graciously opened doors at every turn, as did archaeologist Dr. Luisa Musso, his wife. The expertise of Professor Stephen Urys was indispensable in my quest to represent accurately the legal landscape of antiquities, but I bear complete responsibility for any errors or omissions. One of his best students, Catherine Brennan, consented to take on the critical role of research assistant. Besides researching references and importing footnotes, she was a first-rate reader and sounding board, and I owe her a great debt. She too is, however, blameless for any missteps made in the book. My editor at Oxford University Press, Sarah Pirovitz, first approached me about this undertaking and marched me ably through every sequence in its realization. A good editor is all that stands between a book's welcome reception and ignominy, and I thank her warmly. May 2016, New York City. Foreword. Over 3 million shipwrecks are at rest on the ocean floor, many laden with priceless art treasures and artifacts from thousands of years ago. Their fate is uncertain as the technology of underwater exploration improves. Back on land, museums ringing the Mediterranean, the Black Sea, and countless other bodies of water are crammed with unphotographed objects lacking scientific documentation. The legal case for a source country retaining all objects found within that nation's borders is clear. What's not so obvious is what is best for those objects. If extant museum basements are full, yet most of the ancient world is still underwater and underground, a good part of Pompeii awaits excavation, how will the resources be found to safeguard, document, and share the importance of tens of millions of as yet undiscovered artifacts? The continuous terrestrial development and modernization of every nation reveals evidence of the remote past on a daily basis, much of it unreported and ending up in a black market of indeterminate size. Modern-day iconoclasts, including the Taliban and Islamic State, are destroying monuments or selling objects on the same illicit market. They are but the latest entrance into an ignoble history of looters that stretches back to ancient Egypt, including a range of actors from farmers to unscrupulous excavation guards to members of syndicates and organized crime families. Today's wanton destruction of ancient monuments, temples, and other public buildings in Syria and Iraq strikes at the very core of our humanity. Any lavishly made structure that has stood reasonably intact for 2,000 years has been a backdrop to the lives of countless millions over centuries. Its intentional obliteration, born of a quest to conscript young people by erasing their heritage and history, wipes away not only the evidence of ingenious engineering and design talent, it also robs us all of a touchstone of the human experiment's continuity. This book is intended for any reader curious about the world behind these dramatic headlines, including those who might reasonably assume that antiquities pertain only to the past. Everyone alive today is literally standing on top of layers of history extending back to the Paleolithic era. Our contemporary surroundings often reveal little or nothing about the past beneath our feet. But that largely invisible past defines us. It shapes the ways in which we live, work, and play, the values we hold, and the ways our civilization will in time be judged. The study of antiquities is as old as human history, but the public's attraction to its study has ebbed and flowed over time, and is stirred up by momentous discoveries like the tomb of Tutankhamun in 1922, or by tragedies like the current destruction of monuments and sites in the Middle East. There is no agreement on what is to become of these objects in the fullness of time. International waters are just that. Antiquities found by chance or intentionally looted appear in fashionable galleries without a passport or a ticket home, and these displaced artifacts circulate in a murky trade, the ill-gotten gains of countless and faceless protagonists. Questions raised by chance discovery and intentional looting of the past are legion, as are questions about the policing of amateur exploration, the efficacy of scientific state-sponsored excavations, treasure laws rewarding metal detector-bearing individuals, national laws forbidding export of ancient objects, and the creation and promulgation of public and private collections of such material. Tens of millions of people visit museums annually. These visitors spend countless hours examining objects both with a well-known history and those with very little. This book will equip museum goers with a fuller understanding of the questions they should have when considering antiquities in any setting, in the modern nation where they were discovered, in the international galleries and auction houses where they may be offered for sale, and in the private residences and public museums where they often end up. Readers of this book may have observed the volley of accusations and retorts about antiquities in the media, popular press, and previous books. However, they may have done so without a frame of reference to make their own judgments. Antiquities is intended to provide a reasoned summary of the fairest way to assess these controversies and the new ones that will inevitably arise. Antiquities is divided into three sections. The first explores the fault lines between archaeologists and those seeking to own antiquities. The second offers a readable guide to the international treaties and national laws that govern the discovery and trade in antiquities. And the third section elucidates the likely fate awaiting works yet undiscovered and those that are the subject of study or of claims by others. I strive to take a balanced and nuanced approach to the issues, assessing arguments on both sides of the debate, and providing insight into how these positions were formed. The primary objective of the book is to equip readers with what they need for an informed encounter with examples of ancient heritage and with those professionals who today devote their lives to the protection and enjoyment of our common past. And the last chapter forecasts potential approaches to caring for our archaeological heritage. Part 1. Legal and Practical Realities. Chapter 1. Defining Antiquities. What are the differences among antiquities, archaeological materials, and ancient art? Antiquities are defined in the Oxford English Dictionary as the remains of monuments of antiquity, ancient relics. The first cited use is from the early 16th century. This chapter will spell out how antiquity may be reasonably defined in each of a number of distinct cultures. But we begin by dividing antiquities into two separate but related categories, archaeological materials and ancient art. How is archaeological material defined? We'll start with a legally binding definition adopted by the United States. The Cultural Property Implementation Act, CPIA, was enacted by the U.S. Congress in 1982 to implement the 1970 UNESCO Convention on the Means of Prohibiting and Preventing the Illicit Import, Export, and Transfer of Ownership of Cultural Property. In the language of the Act, the phrase archaeological material is defined as an object that, one, is of cultural significance, two, is at least 250 years old, and three, was normally discovered as a result of scientific excavation, clandestine or accidental digging, or exploration on land or underwater. The CPIA's classification of the circumstances of discovery bears further consideration. Objects found through scientific inquiry are normally documented from the moment of their discovery. Objects retrieved through scientific excavation are typically afforded the protection of state authorities and are retrieved, documented, and stored by academic and museums officials within the source country, also known as the country of origin. That they may be subsequently stolen is the reason for their mention in the CPIA. Objects that come to light as a result of clandestine excavation or chance finds are also afforded protection by the Act. How are scientifically excavated objects removed from under land or water? Field archaeologists painstakingly record the discovery of virtually every single element of a professional excavation. Even the humblest mass-produced artifacts that are purely functional, bearing minimal or no decoration. The archaeologist makes on-the-spot decisions about the significance of finds, concentrating on those discoveries that may shed the most light on their context. The goal in recording evidence of the past is to speculate about the character and attributes of a human settlement, religious sanctuary, burial, place of assembly or commerce, shipwreck, or any other of a number of contexts revealed through excavation. Integral to the act of excavation is exploring features of the natural environment in which human activity took place and surmising both the conditions original to a context as well as the factors over time that may have disrupted or altered the find spot or location of a discovery. The documentation accompanying each find normally begins with the context, consisting of geographical coordinates, followed by categorization and dimensions of finds, soil composition and attributes, the stratigraphy or measurement of the layer below ground in which a find was made, drawings of sections, the vertical surfaces revealed, and plans, the horizontal surfaces, and photographs. The finds record describes those elements of a site that are removed when special finds are made, such as artifacts deemed deserving of further excavation. They're separated from general finds that aren't initially presumed to warrant immediate attention. Special finds made of inorganic or water-resistant materials, like limestone, marble, and fired ceramics, are typically washed soon after excavation to prevent the hardening of deposits on them as a result of fresh exposure to the elements. Objects made of metal, wood, or other organic materials are best reserved for examination and treatment in a conservation laboratory. The finds are then identified with discrete but legible markings somewhere on the surface, typically including the site and context numbers. Once all of the steps are completed, a scientific excavation is followed by finds analysis. In this phase, information that can be gleaned either from the particular circumstances of discovery or from comparison with other similar or identical finds leads the archaeologist to offer interpretations about the typology, date, and function of an artifact. The consideration of a critical mass of artifacts removed from a find spot then leads the archaeologist to informed speculation about the context as a whole. The excavator then offers a plausible scenario of how the finds made their way to a context and what transpired there. For a field archaeologist, the fact that an example of archaeological material may be precious by virtue of its material, such as gold or silver, or because it happens to be ornate, poses a challenge. Its inherent value may be obvious to even an uninformed observer. But unless the circumstances of its discovery are clear, its utility as a piece of the puzzle explaining the context may be inferior to an undecorated pot shard bearing an inscription. Archaeologists understandably tread carefully when confronted with ancient luxury goods, because the quest in excavation is not to find precious objects. It is to tell a complete story about the people who left traces of their life behind. Accounts in popular culture, such as the Indiana Jones movie franchise, gloss over the painstaking practices of scientific excavation and glamorize the discovery of baubles. These reenactments fuel an anti-scientific impulse, manifested across a spectrum of activities ranging from amateur excavation to looting. Thus, the sensitivity of the archaeological community about the discovery of objects with an imputed high market value is completely understandable. Scientists obviously recoil at the possibility that the fruits of their rigorous, objective methodology could incentivize the intentional destruction of undisturbed sites in a search for treasure. It is human nature for an archaeologist to recognize that a gold vessel found among plain pot fragments deserves particular attention and appreciation. But that doesn't countenance fetishization. Years ago, at a conference of the Archaeological Institute of America, I heard the great underwater archaeologist George Bass presenting recent finds from his excavation off the coast of Kuşadası, Turkey. As he clicked through slides showing finds, a gold vessel appeared on the screen. As an art historian, not a field archaeologist, my pulse quickened. But Professor Bass offered this object no more screen time than an assortment of shards from glass vessels. The audience of archaeologists evinced no trace of interest in the gold vessel greater than that accorded the glass fragments. Their emotional equanimity in the face of what was doubtless just as prized in antiquity as it is today revealed a great deal about how differently archaeologists and art historians view evidence of the past. For archaeologists, finds are information, indispensable in elucidating a context for human habitation. For art historians, some finds are more deserving of attention than others, simply by virtue of rarity or quality of craftsmanship. The contest for supremacy between these two points of view has led to a standoff that serves neither the scientific record of the past nor the public interest. It hinders agreement on a concerted, shared plan to disincentivize looting and interdict stolen artifacts. And it renders each constituency incredulous at the short-sightedness of the other. Archaeological materials that see the light of day from clandestine looting, public works, private construction, and other circumstances will be considered in detail in Chapter 8. But in summary, these are objects that were normally removed from an archaeological context with minimal or no accompanying trace of scientific evidence about their find spot or context. The spectrum of circumstances ranges from innocent discovery in the course of digging a building foundation to the rapacious strip mining of known sites in Syria and Iraq that we witness at the hands of multiple factions today. How is ancient art defined? For the purposes of this book, ancient artworks consist of objects created in antiquity that lack a known archaeological context or setting. An example would be a Roman marble portrait in a museum display, which found its way into a collection without evidence of its discovery, and typically with a less than complete record of its past ownership history. It might be classified and dated by means of comparisons with other portrait heads discovered in a context, including coins, inscriptions, or other precise means of assigning a date. But it comes down to us through history with no equivalent of a birth certificate or passport. While archaeological materials normally end up in museum storerooms near their place of discovery or in a regional or national museum in their country of origin, ancient artworks can be found in almost any setting: a public museum, auction catalog, gallery storefront, private collection, or on eBay. Objects separated from their ancient find spot may have appeared on the legal or illicit art market recently or in the distant past. They may have been part of centuries or decades-old collections, or may have been deaccessioned or officially removed from a collection for any of a variety of reasons. Like archaeological materials, ancient artworks range from a level of extraordinary quality to utterly negligible significance. While mass production as we understand it today is automated or digital, yielding multiple or even unlimited examples of a given form, the precursor to mass production in antiquity involved molds, yielding multiple casts or impressions that still required an artisan's touch to complete it. Such would be the case for bronzes cast from a mold, molten glass poured into a mold, terracotta vessels bearing stamped decoration, or struck coins requiring burnishing. But we may generalize that ancient artworks run the gamut from unique to commonplace. That spectrum of rarity is connected with another characteristic distinguishing ancient artworks from the best-known category of archaeological materials, those that were scientifically excavated. Since archaeological materials excavated under state supervision cannot be sold legally in most countries, they technically have no fair market value. Ancient art, by contrast, is traded and has a fair market value that contributes to its continuous appreciation and protection from damage, neglect, or loss. The word art attached to this category of antiquities implies that they're worth our contemplation. Their market value may run from hundreds to millions of dollars. In the past, the market value of works of ancient art was indexed to, as suggested, their degree of rarity and ornamental sophistication. Since the three-decade-old tightening of export controls, prosecution of those involved in illicit trade, and the advent of more stringent standards for proof of good title by museums, there's been a sea change in the art market's appraisal of ancient artworks. Those objects that have reliable evidence of ownership, predating the 1970 UNESCO Convention on the Means of Prohibiting and Preventing the Illicit Import, Export, and Transfer of Ownership of Cultural Property, today have a significantly higher valuation, regardless of their intrinsic quality as artworks. This is a salutary development in signaling to looters that objects without a verifiable and legitimate ownership history are worth much less in the market than those with such a trail. It's to be hoped that over time, the stigmatization of antiquities lacking credible and documented history will discourage both looting and trade in illegally or accidentally discovered artifacts. Are there accepted arbiters of these definitions? Bundling these two categories, archaeological material and ancient art, into the larger category of antiquities helps our inquiry, since sometimes objects can move from one category to another based on newly uncovered evidence. such as the case with the upper half of a statue of Heracles, purchased by the Museum of Fine Arts of Boston in 1981. It entered the collection as a work of ancient art, without any awareness of the circumstances of its discovery. In 2011, the museum restituted the sculpture to Turkish authorities after it was proven that it joined the bottom half of the statue, which had been excavated in 1980 in the South Bath complex at the site of Perge. Overnight, it went from being a masterwork of ancient art to inheriting archaeological significance. The display in Boston simply identified it as one of a number of versions of the Weary Heracles, derived from a lost original by the 4th century BCE master sculptor Lysippus. But its identification as part of the excavations at Perge has yielded a more nuanced and complete understanding of the object. The statue figured in a sculptural ensemble adorning the long hall of a bath complex in Perge, accompanied by multiple statues of other Greek gods and heroes, commissioned by one Claudius Pison, whose name was inscribed on each. Instead of being a freestanding statue, it was part of an opulent dedication, attesting to the refinement and wealth of its donor in a procession of figures connected with the practical function of the baths. There is no professional body dedicated to determining which of these two categories of antiquities a given object belongs to. That classification is not legally relevant. Categorization is nevertheless a practical necessity, since an object with archaeological context is more likely to be of material interest to potential claimants, including government agencies responsible for tracking down examples of heritage that belong to a given country. An ancient artwork may be harder to claim, since there may be no legally compelling or even circumstantial evidence that it was obtained illegally. There's an understandable reluctance on the part of academics to parse the definitions of these interrelated categories too precisely. In general, the archaeological community finds the term ancient art to be unscientific, since art invokes a universal but completely elastic category of creativity. To a scientist searching for signification from artifacts, the word art is a problematic one, implying, as it does, an inherent virtuosity, separate and apart from functionality. A museum curator might describe an ornate 7th century BCE fibula as a work of art, whereas for an archaeologist, it is, however intricate, still just a forebear to today's safety pin. The discipline of archaeology has a long history and has been practiced in varying ways. In Europe, where it may be said to have been invented in the 18th century, it's a separate discipline born of early encounters with the legacy of Greek, Roman, Near Eastern, and Egyptian civilizations. Within the United States, archaeology is normally considered to be one branch of anthropology, the other three being cultural anthropology, physical anthropology, and linguistics. More broadly, the field is practiced by scientists focused on prehistoric, historical, classical, and industrial archaeology. Museum professionals are keen to arrive at clear definitions, since within the larger rubric of antiquities, they would normally find archaeological materials to be ineligible for acquisition by gift, bequest, purchase, or transfer. By its very nature, an archaeological object once pertained to a particular site or find spot, and new evidence might eventually come to light that could prompt a claim by a state party. Thus, for museums still acquiring antiquities, the evidentiary standard is ever higher, and responsible museum directors and trustees are increasingly reluctant to acquire objects that may later invite scrutiny, claims, or restitution, at times accompanied by legal bills, reputational harm, and a loss of funds expended to purchase, conserve, publish, and display a given work. How have these definitions changed over time? As early as the Greek historian Herodotus, circa 484 to 425 BCE, there have long been inquiries into the art and archaeology of the past. His set of 9 books, titled The Histories, provides the first known written accounts of ancient cultures. The ancient Romans identified their Greek forebears as ancient. Livy, 64 to 59 BC to AD 17, wrote negatively about the triumph of Gnaeus Manlius in 187 BC, which introduced to Rome a large array of luxury goods from Asia Minor, or modern Turkey. For Livy, this influx of Greek art contributed to a decline in the moral integrity of Republican Rome. While lamentations about art's damaging influence on social order continue to this day, it's clear that for Livy and later Roman authors who wrote about art of the Greek world, veneration of the art of antiquity was a powerful force in contemporary society. Archaeology as a discipline began in earnest during the Enlightenment in the 18th century. Its evolution toward a more scientific line of inquiry throughout the 19th and 20th centuries led to nuanced demarcations of the function, style, and dating of ancient objects, and indeed to divergent opinions about the definition of art as a category, separate and apart from the entire material inheritance of the past. But the trend to classify ancient artworks separately from archaeological materials is a recent one, precipitated by increased attention to national patrimony claims and the legal battles that have followed. At the close of this chapter, we will grapple with the dividing line between antiquity and the periods that followed it across multiple cultures, typically described as medieval. How do different countries define antiquities? There are great differences of opinion among countries in how best to describe their cultural inheritance. We'll review the current positions in Chapter 6 when considering treaties, laws, and statutes. For now, let's say that such definitions are largely political in nature rather than grounded in scientific inquiry. What are the differences among countries, nations, and state parties? The terms are often used interchangeably, which can lead to confusion. Country is the most informal locution, which is loosely used to describe a nation as an historical construct without regard to its exact current borders. Nation-state is an antiquated locution denoting a country in which the population is from a single ethnic stock, cohabitating with a shared cultural identity. Nation is the most commonly used term to define a contemporary country. And state party is a diplomatic term to refer to a nation that has agreed to be a party to a treaty or international agreement. How do scholars define antiquity differently from culture to culture? While national interests dictate hard and fast bright lines, defining the date after which an object is determined to have left its country of origin illegally, that is not synonymous with a definition of antiquity. The challenge is that most modern nations under whose land and water lie remnants of the past are not focused on arriving at a date with a scholarly explanation. They instead take the position that more important than specifying the date of inception of a post-ancient era is the protection of cultural heritage. As a result, the dates that are the focus of most countries have little to do with clarifying relevant historical periods and everything to do with prohibiting the outward flow of cultural property that they consider their patrimony. Scholars have long grappled with a definition of the end of antiquity, but the majority of interested parties are content to leave definitions of the end of antiquity in a given culture or civilization to the modern nation resting above its remains. For our purposes, it's useful to clarify when antiquity may be said to have ended in each major culture from the past. Every ancient civilization developed at its own pace.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.